Okay, so I'll be presenting on Inkscape. Hi, I'm Andy. I work for a small North American software company. Our software runs on stock markets and animation studios alike, so we're doing all right. 2,187, that's the number of Windows people, just Windows people, that have gone to the Inkscape website, not in a CD, not a redistributor, not through the repo themselves. That's the number of people who got Inkscape today. And that's my labor of love, my passion for the past decade, nothing to do with my job as an experienced designer, just a tool that I think is pretty cool and doesn't really get as much street cred as the others. But not here to pick fights and find an antagonist. Actually, it's a piece of a tool channel. Almost everybody I know who uses it does pair it with another tool, you know, because it's not an environment unto itself. But look, I've seen the drama that using this machine has caused. So I'm going to go into Linux because that's where I feel safe. All right, I'm in. All right, so here it is. We have Mac builds, Windows builds, Linux builds. Back in the old days, there was like Solaris builds and BLS stuff and all of that. But there's a really interesting story, and I'm going to tell the story because you convinced me behind Inkscape. Now, a long, long time ago, before this big company called Adobe acquired a smaller company called Macromedia, it was the dawn of the web. Every single website that was cool had a Flash intro, and Adobe was losing mileage. They were not having ownership of a creation suite that was driving a lot of entertainment and content online. Adobe did the best thing an open source hippie could possibly do at the time. They partnered with one of the standards boards and decided, let's write a spec to do scalable vector graphics. Let's do open vector graphics for the web. Let's try and circumvent this whole mess of one proprietary company owning this infrastructure, and let's write a spec. So they put some of their smartest people on it. They donated a whole lot of code, and they built the perfect ecosystem for what we now see when you use Google Maps on your Android phone, when you open up your Canon camera, when you use almost any website with pretty infographs before Canvas really took off. You're using SVG. Again, back to the narrative, SVG was just the draft specification, so that's, you know, kind of dry and boring, but this really nice guy called Rafe Levine, he looked at the draft spec and he thought, this is awesome, this is so cool, I'm going to write a reference implementation of how we can use this. And he did the simple stuff, like this is how you draw a rectangle, this is how you draw a circle, and that was it. It looked beautiful. He used a library that gave us great anti-alias lines, and in the late 90s, anti-alias lines were the hotness. And eventually, he got bored of it and moved on to his next fun thing, which is typography. Fast forward a few iterations, the code changed hands, because that's what open source code does. It became a program called Study Potty. A guy called Laurie Kaplinski really wrote some awesome stuff to start manipulating these paths, doing more than just drawing circles and squares, but actually lines and further interesting pieces of geometry. Some really nice guys out of Monash Uni in Melbourne thought, well, we're studying computational geometry and adaptive layouts. What we might do is just do all of our reference code inside of this thing, Inkscape, you know, because we need somewhere to put it in, and it's not like we can just call up Microsoft and say, can we put this in Visio? So Inkscape started getting lots and lots and lots of code donation from really, really cool people doing really, really cutting-edge stuff. And it still does to this day. In fact, Rafe, the guy who first started the project, is the guy at Google behind the Web Fonts project. His 20% time is why Google Web Fonts exist. So, full circle, here is Inkscape. And I introduce it to you. I'm actually running a nightly build, so when it crashes, it's just because, you know, it wasn't actually released. It has your standard tools, you know, you can draw geometry, or you can manipulate it, you can actually start breaking it apart. you can create what's, I mean, every other tool has this, but you can create what's called like a reference clone. Now, SVG is if you're not familiar with the format, it's like HTML, it's an XML format. In fact, it uses CSS, and there's some SVG-specific CSS it can use, but it uses most of the CSS you're familiar with. When you put SVG inside of a web page, almost all of the modern browsers, in fact, all of the modern browsers will load the SVG. This is great if you need to design something for a client with a Retina display. You don't have to double your bandwidth by loading up a massively expensive image. You can just load the SVG first, know the modern browser will get it, and then fall back to the PNG in case there's any issues. So that's one of the nice things about it. The cool thing about a reference clone is, yeah, whenever you do something to one image, it will actually do it to the previous. So you can see that all the effects that I've done to this one star are there. A lot of cool stuff's happened with the tool, where we can now actually start doing things like spraying references of the object. And that's cool because whenever we change the original object, we get to change the children. Now if I just unstar this, and I give you a quick preview, you can actually see in the XML document that there's a star parameter for this object. If I actually just remove the star, I can now individually change the color and different settings for all of these objects. But whenever I change something like the number of shapes this star has, that seems to stay put. We have a really cool tool for manipulating objects en masse as well, so dealing with, you know, a bunch of references. And that's this thing, it's a little warp tool, it's kind of cool. We can use it to color, so you can actually like start jittering the color. You can use it to straight up paint, you know, so I want to use this green object right here and start painting this series of objects. What you can do is actually apply this to typography. So I'll grab my spray tool, start spraying stuff. Now the whole idea of this is that in the XML you're only writing the text once. Now, for our technical documentation at Red Hat, we have to translate every single diagram we do into at least 24 languages. That's 24 supported languages for all our customers around the world. That means that some poor bugger has to write down a very technical concept in a tool that they're, you know, all illustrative tools aren't that comfortable for somebody who's that, you know, involved in their work. They have to write it down in this tool, and then every single person that translates it, the typical workflow is that they have to change those strings by, you know, getting the license for the software for that region, getting a workstation, learning to use the software, opening the file, saving the file, putting it on the staging server. With this, all of these bits of text that I'm using are now only referenced by this one text ID. Everything else is what's called a use, and it has, you know, an XREF, like a HREF. So that means that you've got a really tiny document, and I can't really stress how tiny SVG is. You can get something that would be, you know, 10 meg as an image with, you know, just a couple K, like 20K as an SVG file. Now, people usually don't believe that it runs on Mac, because that's one of the biggest areas that we struggle with, but it does. So I actually, instead of bringing the PC out of the office, I brought a Mac just to show you the difference, the kind of thing. Should load up. Okay, so here it is on the Mac as well. This is same old style of build. Now, I actually just changed the icon set on the side. Everything that is in this app is drawn with SVG as well, which is kind of cool. It's kind of like we made it with itself. The app icon, yeah, here we go. The app icon made in Inkscape. A whole lot of other app icons made in Inkscape. In fact, a hell of a lot of people making iOS icons, making Android icons, you know, whatever else, they're all using Inkscape. I think one of the key things about Inkscape is how small you can get to working with it. Like, you know, this is for dealing with, I actually draw all my pixel art, and I'm not a very massive graphic designer, but I did do all of this stuff. All of the pixel art that I do is done in SVG first, because if I ever need to upscale it, I have the opportunity. I give the geometry, you know, some sort of form, but then I start hinting it. So in the case of here, you can see that pixel will have about 75% opacity coverage. you know, if it is just an on or off pixel. But when I upscale it, it's obviously going to form, you know, to be the curve. So it's a nice way of, you know, using vector graphics to future-proof stuff that you're currently doing on a very small grid. It, you know, stops your future work from looking like, you know, 8-bit artwork. Now, all of this stuff is still Inkscape, so you know, all of the artwork is pretty much all vector artwork. You can actually check out the source. We can turn off filters because that's one of the computationally expensive things. This is a 5-year-old computer, so it's actually, you know, struggling a little bit. But you can check out that all of this stuff is still, yep, just flat shapes. I've given it a few containers. This object here is a simple outline. I've, you know, done a bunch of duplicating of shapes and stuff to draw these objects. Now, all of this stuff is nice and flashy, but I want to actually show you one of the truly cool things about Inkscape if you are into design tools. The first thing is that we have 8x anti-aliasing, and Illustrator has 3. You know, like, we have smoother lines. That's really nothing to brag about, but that's kind of... I want to go the antagonist route, so I'm kind of like, come on, what can we do? We do all live transforming, so you actually get to see the real render as it's rendered. There's none of that short-cutting outline stuff where you don't really know where you are when you're resizing things. But we have this type of line, thank you, Mr. Levine, called a spiral spline. Now, who here has actually used a vector graphics tool before? I'm in good company. All right, who knows what cubic Beziers are? Boom, the 3 geeks out of the... You guys passed the test. Okay, so cubic Beziers is what Inkscape, or what SVG uses to describe node coordinates. It's also what the TTF font format uses for describing the shapes of a font. It's a simple line that you would have probably seen before, where if you draw this up, you move across and you draw this up, you'll get what looks like a bit of an arc curve. Now, the sad truth about cubic Beziers is you cannot draw a perfect circle. You can never draw a perfect circle, ever, with cubic Beziers. A lot of people shortchange themselves, you know, they add extra nodes and they fiddle with them, they try and, you know, fit it in to be a perfect circle. Now, obviously, you're going to get really close and, you know, within some realm of fidelity, you're going to stop and go, you know what, that line's smooth enough. But the whole concept of playing with lines, the whole concept, the whole idea of just that line should be a circular line has gone. You're actually now fighting the computer to work at creating more eloquent, you know, lines and artwork. So it's kind of like a weird, this is what modern day graphic software has done to us. We actually are now adding all of these different control points and trying to manipulate them just to get what we want, when really it should be a lot easier. Now, Rafe did the absolute coolest thing ever when he did Spyro. The guy loves typography. He loves the assumption of a perfect curve. And now it's not the 1970s anymore. Computational geometry can afford some of this math. But this is a smooth control point followed by 2 cusp control points. That's a perfect circle. I mean, a perfect arc at least. That's a perfect spiral. And the more you manipulate these shapes, the more you see that you don't even need those control handles because they do nothing. You actually see that you're actually just bending the assumption of what is a perfect line. Now, to illustrate that from scratch is actually a really labor of love thing to do if you're using any other illustration software. But with Inkscape, you kind of get it for free. And not only that, you can do all of the cool stuff, like throwing your text along that path. Which is really good. And the thing to note, actually, is that, you know, this stuff is live updating. So if you use this as the source for some artwork on your website, you can just keep the SVG asset on your server and update that SVG, and Inkscape will run it for you. What we do is we add a bunch of extra namespace stuff to an SVG file just to keep Inkscape aware of what's happening to the document. But we always bake it down to real SVG. All of this stuff is really old and not that impressive, so I'm going to get on to the 2012, to the next level stuff, to the future. All right, strokes and paths are really hard to deal with. You can stroke something, but you can't really affect the stroke. Again, protagonist, illustrator, even though, you know what, like, people grab their artwork and then they bring it into Illustrator to do color managed stuff. Like, there is no real protagonist, but I'm going to keep that going. We have this path effect editor, and we have something called pattern along path. Here we are. So I'm going to draw a little star. I'm going to remove the stroke of that star. I'm going to say, yeah, that's all right. That's a good enough shape. I'm going to copy that to the clipboard, and then I'm going to add a pattern along path. Now, if I paste that, what I'm actually getting is that pattern along this path. Now, that's kind of nice, because then I can articulate that as a solid shape. But it's also, again, not how I think about manipulating a shape. You know, like, there's a lot of tools that do this whole give me a live effect along a shape. But what you really want is to match the mental model of how somebody thinks about creating an object on a shape. This is why I'm going back to Linux, to my comfort zone, because can everybody see that? Now, a guy called Johan Englund just added this code. And what it does is it allows us to add control points to a path, so we have the benefit of the perfect circle, but we can also change the thickness and the thinness, and, you know, start manipulating things in a more elegant way. I'm going to open up a couple examples, because I'm not a real illustrator. You know, I kind of fidget. I'm a tweaker, as they call them. I'm getting married soon, and I can't afford the Jessica Hishes or the great, you know, typographers or letterers or any of those artists to do something really cool for me. And I'm probably glad, because, you know, it would always be somebody else's work. So I had to start using this tool that only came out a couple weeks ago, like today, because I needed to print something tomorrow. So I'm actually printing this stuff tomorrow. So I actually really, you know, need this work to be analyzed by a bunch of designers for free. All right, so here's the lettering that I did. And here's a bunch of the flourishes. Now, if I wanted that line here to extend a bit further, and I was using any other tool, it would be really, really hard. But with Inkscape, I can actually just grab the control point, you know, up the thickness, and I've got myself a nice, like, you know, delicious, ornate, you know, Art Nouveau style. It's really easy to do. Guys, I can actually design now. I feel, like, really empowered that all of those flourishes and cool ornaments and stuff like that that used to be, like, you know, the master craftsman style, you know, access. You had to either go to some really sleazy site to download your vector pack or whatever, you know. Like, now you can just create it. You can go, I want it to match this arc, and here it is. So that's really cool. I absolutely love it. And Inkscape does all of that. I'm going to switch now to another tool that isn't Inkscape. And in fact, it's kind of like the ugly older brother of Inkscape, because he's twice as smart, you know, really does well for himself, but he was born in another time, so he looks a bit different. This is FontForge, and it's probably the tool that the web developers in the room will love using. Now, I use a bunch of tools for web dev. One's called IcoMoon. There's another one called Font. Oh, I've forgotten the name. But Fontello? Yeah, Fontello. Fontello is good because it's actually open source, and you can, you know, fork it and add your own glyphs. IcoMoon is great because you can actually upload an SVG file that you've created and save that as a glyph in a custom web font. So you're getting a web font full of all the symbolic glyphs you want and none of the ones you don't. FontForge is a little bit cooler because you can actually go crazy deep into the font files you're creating, deleting glyphs, changing the index of the glyph, adding the specific line work, you know, and actually, like, make this font a real font. And it's a full-featured font studio. And when I say full-featured, I mean there isn't a single tool for editing fonts that does all of the things that FontForge does. It saves web font format, it saves SVG fonts, it saves OpenType, TrueType, PostScript, Type 1. It goes all the way back to PS. So it's a really cool tool. Unfortunately, it kind of looks like this, you know, like you have to get your glyph, you've got your node point. One thing that is cool about FontForge, though, is you can actually get information on a particular point. And no one ever really sees this stuff about just one point in a vector shape. But this is everything about the offset, the angle, the direction. You can see there's one weird rule about making fonts. If you're going to do an inset, it has to be anti-clockwise. And if you're going to do an outset, it has to be clockwise. And you won't ever notice that thing until, like, you're on somebody else's computer and, you know, shapes are all filled in and things are all messed up. So this helps you debug that kind of stuff. And if you're going to have a web font that does just one thing, like your logo, this is the way to make sure that that web font is like 5K big, absolutely tiny, and does not stuff up even when people print it. Because the big thing about web fonts is when people print it, they kind of go crazy. All right. Back on out to the example. Right. Actually, let's start a new one. Okay, people are familiar with working with layers, and layers in SVG don't exist. Groups do. You can group any object. So we have just created the parent level of groups to be the layers. So therefore, when you create a layer, you're just affecting a group. It's a little trick we played just to make sure that people who are familiar with working with layers can do so. So in this case, I can add a bunch of different layers. You know, I'll add layer 1, add layer 2. And the first thing I want to do is back to that cool example of like the star that I had before. And the star tool is just like absolutely fantastic. You can do like really cool, beautiful stuff with it. Like you can absolutely go nuts. But I'm going to create this star. I'm going to group him first, just for safekeeping, because what's going to happen is in the XML behind this is I'm going to reference that group instead of referencing that star. That means I can put other things inside that group later if I want to. I'm going to grab my cool spray can, because, you know, that's my new favorite tool. My old favorite tool was this thing, where you can actually just illustrate. You know, and that created some really nice artwork. But I'm going to grab this spray can. I'm going to make sure that the spray can's creating clones of an object. I'm going to set the rotation, set the scale. Yep. Okay. I'm going to kill... off the style of the parent one. Now, if you ever lose which one is your parent, you can always go to your edit, clone, select original, and it goes to whatever's being referenced. That's one thing that, you know, you can also hide it from view in the document and stuff like that. But in this case, I'm actually going to turn off the style for all of these. So that's the group has no style. The child, yeah, also has no style. Hang on, where's that? Jeez, how can people use Max? Alright, and I'm going to go again with that warp tool. And the first thing I'm going to do is just make some things a little bit more rotated. Shrink down these in the area where I don't like the intensity. I'll grab a green, I want to mix in some green. I'll grab a blue, mix in some blue, grab a little bit of red. You know, and maybe just down the focus a bit and jitter the colors just to get a little bit of texture in there. Now I've got all these objects, but they're not quite right. I can use the alignment tool to scatter the alignment so that they actually have enough space for each other. I can skip that whole thing and try again by randomizing them within my selection. I can force them to never overlap, or I can set the amount at which they're allowed to overlap by setting a negative value. So they're allowed to horizontally overlap by 33. Obviously, 33 isn't much. And I can also, you know, do the alignment things that other tools also use. Back onto the layers. behind all of this, I'll draw a nice like green color. Send it to the back. Go up a layer. Draw another color. Set that layer to like, so we've got the blend modes as well. SVG has blend modes. Now, even if you don't actually use Inkscape for anything at all, it's great for looting. It's great for looting SVG filters. It's great for looting how to easily load an image and make a small modification. And it's great for stealing SVG-specific CSS that you can use to apply really complex Photoshop-esque filters to your web pages, because you can do all of the transformations, the rotations, the blurring, the multiplication factors, all of that stuff, and all the browsers do support it. It's just not that many people use it, so you can use Inkscape to do that. And let's see, grab another text layer. Open Sans is a great font. We hired a guy to do an open font for us. We called it Liberation Sans. It was meant to be the metric equivalent of the Arial font, so that when people opened up their word processors, things didn't break. And we got it. It was an all right font, but it was worse than Matthew Carter's Vedana. And now he comes out with Open Sans, and the thing is just, it's perfect. You know, I wish we could just do a swap. But anyway, I've shown enough about Inkscape. I have plenty of things that you can do. Almost anything that you've seen accomplished visually can be done. We have a great vector tracer, so you can actually open up a bitmap file, and our PoTrace can do multiple pass optimization to try and vectorize things that aren't vector. That's really cool. It's kind of a good tool, and I think more and more people will be using it as resolution independence becomes a big thing, and as the fact that SVG has become the de facto supported standard. It's only taken 10 years, but you know, whatever. So yeah, I don't know, I've got another, like just a little scrapbook of stuff. Let's see what else we've got. This brush medley chromey cloud thing in the background, Inkscape, SVG, you know, it looks like it's a bitmap graphic, but it's actually just a few blur functions. This thing here, all SVG, you know, so you can actually turn off filters, check out the outlines of everything. But really, I mean, this is the worst XML editor you've ever seen. Every text editor that you've got is much better than this guy, but he's kind of what we made when we made him, with the idea that we'd expand out the style parameter to be something else. But this thing helps you look at what you hardly ever see in something you're creating, and that's the ability to select by an ID and by an object. Inkscape is a command line tool as well, so you can export and render PNGs and bitmaps of specific objects. You can say, render out this ID. It has a search tool. You can search by the ID, by something that you've named it by the text. So even if you're working on a massive piece, like a map, and many maps are pretty massive, you can find exactly what you want, get to it, make your modifications, and you can even do all of that from without touching Inkscape at all. The best thing about Inkscape is that when you don't need to use it, you don't need to use it. So yeah, that's Inkscape. And I built a version for Mac. It's on the website, inkscape.org, and you can also get a Windows version that works very well, and of course, if you install any modern popular Linux operating system, chances are it's installed by default. So, thank you.